Daniel not only prepared a place and time, but he prepared the atmosphere. It says he threw open the windows towards Jerusalem. And Jerusalem was 800 miles away, but what it tells me about Daniel is that he had a longing in his heart for home. He never stopped missing home, wanting to go home, wishing he could go home. But I think it also meant that he was focusing on the Lord God of his fathers, the living God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In the midst of a pagan culture with everybody saying they had their own gods, Daniel was focused in prayer on the one true living God. And we'll talk more about that in the next session, just centering down on who God is when we speak to him in prayer. But Daniel created that atmosphere when he threw open his windows towards Jerusalem, reminding himself of the person to whom he was praying and his longing for home, that one day he would go to his heavenly home. For you and me, for myself, I want to throw open the windows of my heart towards home also. And when I pray, know that this life is not all there is. I'm going home, and I want my life to be in step with what's eternal values would dictate. I want to remember that I'm just a pilgrim passing through. At the same time, I want to focus on who God is, that he's the creator, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's the father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to stay focused on who God is. So I want to create an atmosphere where I remember to whom I'm speaking, and at the same time, look at it from an eternal perspective. Daniel prepared an atmosphere, and lastly, he prepared his attitude. Daniel, it says, got down on his knees. When was the last time you prayed on your knees? Have you ever prayed on your knees? Try it. You'll see the difference it makes in your attitude. There's something about praying on your knees. It's not just bowing your knee. It's bowing your heart before God. And it may be hard to do, as I've gotten older, it's harder for me because I have a torn meniscus in one knee, I have arthritis in the other, so I can't stay on my knees for long, but I want to bow the knee before God because God is God, and we are we, and we need to remember the difference, and we bow our knee out of worship and respect and reverence and submission to his authority. So if you say not just that you can't bow the knee for some physical difficulty, but you won't bow the knee, then you need an attitude check. When we come before God, if we're going to pray the Daniel prayer, we need to prepare our attitude, and it needs to be one of worship and submission to the authority of his lordship. Next time you meet the Lord in prayer, just slip down on your knees and see the difference it makes in your attitude. Daniel also gave thanks to the Lord, and I want you to just think about that for a moment. First time I really meditated on that, it just caught me up short because I thought, goodness, think of all that Daniel has been through. Captured when he's 15 or, 14 or 15 years of age, separated from his family and friends, it would be terrifying. Dragged off to a pagan empire serving a ruthless, cruel emperor who had all the power in the world. He could do anything he chose. His whims became law. Daniel was stripped of everything. Everything changed in his life. And Daniel, we believe, had been emasculated because his immediate superior was chief of the eunuchs. His name was changed to honor a pagan god. His food was changed, or they tried to change his food, to food that was first sacrificed to idols. So he would be giving acknowledgement of idols, every time he ate, which he refused to do. But Daniel, every time he tried to do the right thing, somebody was there to criticize him. His life was threatened continually, again and again. He worked hard because in time he rose to a position of great responsibility and authority in four different world empires. And yet he was always enslaved. He would never go home. And yet when he got down on his knees, he gave thanks. Isn't that amazing that he found reasons to thank God? So if I can put it this way, he just cultivated an attitude of gratitude. What about you? What's interrupted your thanks? Is it when life throws you a curveball? Is it when your hopes and dreams are not realized and you suddenly discover, you just come to grips with the fact they'll never be realized? Is it when people are always watching you to find something wrong? They're criticizing you, fault-finding, jealous of you. Maybe it's in your office or your school or your family. Maybe you're enslaved, so to speak, bound in an abusive marriage, or with an employer who's not fair, or you know, in some other way, maybe a body of pain, maybe because of ill health, you're just enslaved to a physical condition, a handicap. And in such a case, do you give thanks? You know, one reason, one way we can cultivate that thanksgiving is not to look at God through the lens of our circumstances, but to look at our circumstances through the lens of God's love and His purpose. So would you examine your attitude? Maybe you need an attitude check. Is your attitude as you meet the Lord in prayer one of worship and thanksgiving? Would you prepare an attitude of thanksgiving, an attitude of worship? Would you make the time to prepare for the Daniel prayer? A commitment to pray until heaven is moved and nations are changed. And in order to make that kind of commitment, you have to be prepared. So right now, this day, would you prepare a place and prepare a time and prepare the atmosphere and prepare your attitude?